One of my guilty pleasures and entertainment is the Walking Dead universe, both the graphic novels and the television shows. I say guilty because while I find the whole idea spooky, the genre tends to never explain just how a zombie can be created, and bears little resemblance to the origins of the concept from Haitian and, to an extent, Central African folklore, which in the case of Haiti tended to invoke magic to reanimate a corpse. What tries there have been to lend some science to zombies include things like pathogens, parasites, radiation, and so on. None so good on the hard science fiction basis. Or the writers simply do not address it at all, and the zombies are just there without explanation. But none of these are particularly satisfying in the sense that there really isn't a hard science basis that could create a zombie, at least as they are usually depicted, especially the ever-popular ones that are rotting, such as those in The Walking Dead. I would propose a possibility, however, though even it's a huge stretch. It's the invocation of molecular nanotechnology. Here there is some fertile ground because you can do things with cells and brains, such as rewire them or maintain cells without the normal biological means to do so. That, however, wouldn't explain the rotting. It would likely be the opposite for mechanical purposes. But it's a start, and it does sort of resemble some related ideas floating around in futurism and sci-fi, some rather disturbing ideas. These are spooky ideas such as politicians or alien civilizations conspiring to rewire the brains of all humans to think in lockstep, and that being exactly how the perpetrator wanted them to think, without the populace ever knowing that there was a change. This goes far beyond writers like Aldous Huxley and George Orwell. Here you don't need a change in the narrative and revise history. You just tweak everyone's brains with your nanotech to think whatever you want them to, and they'll never be the wiser. Propaganda and slogans in this case are no longer necessary. They have gone obsolete in the face of outright human programming. A way to think about this is nature itself. A polar bear, magnificent as they are, will and do attack humans if the right stimulus is there, such as the need to eat, or another factor that may not be entirely clear to the human. They do as they do, but only because evolution and nature dictates that. That, of course, is not to say that you can't have indifferent ones or nice ones, just that in the wild it's best to steer clear of the polar bears. Let them be, protect their populations, of course, but not a good idea to approach one unless you're a specialist, lest you run up against one of the most powerful predators living in and adapted for one of the harshest environments on Earth. And they are intelligent predators at that. Bears have large brains and seem to actually be really technically minded in some ways, in that they can actually figure out how to unscrew a jar and get at its contents. And in the case of the American black bear and probably others, they can often just ignore wildlife cameras and go about their business. But sometimes they get curious, leading to wildlife cameras sometimes catching bears in the act of trying to figure out this weird new thing in their environment. Bear selfies, they are sometimes termed. But at the same time, for bears and most other animals, nature wins, and they must eat. But we're not all that different when you get down to it. The Donner Party and the Franklin Expedition are a testament to that, and of course there has been much worse on that front. Well, what happens if you have a nanotechnological control standing in for instinct in this scenario? Here, nanotech would literally be changing your thinking as an impulse, as nature does without you really knowing why or if it even happened. Scary stuff, though thankfully we are nowhere close to this kind of technology at our present state of development. But in the future, it may become a problem. Instead of temporary insanity, it becomes technological insanity. Orwell with 1984 and Huxley with Brave New World might have underestimated what might be possible in such scenarios, a potential example of the fiction being tamer than the ultimate reality. That might be one kind of zombie, at least of sorts, call it a nano-zombie. Another type is a hive mind. Here the Borg Collective from Star Trek become a kind of proxy zombie apocalypse. One mind dictating all but as a collective. The individual didn't matter, rather the whole mattered. And the individual was simply a drone. This is of course plausible. You could have such a collective populated with a fusion of biology and technology going through the motions and carrying out functions while the hive mind lives in a virtual reality paradise. For the Borg, though, they sort of went off the rails with that one when they introduced a monarch, the Borg Queen, to bring order to the chaos. That's basically a dictatorship and a hive mind, and that sort of makes it no longer a hive mind. It was much spookier when they were a unified hive mind culture, mysteriously assimilating civilizations and changing them irreparably to become one with them. This is a case where in science fiction, yes, you can do interesting things with the concept, but if you overuse it, then you paint yourself in the corner as you ultimately tell everyone how the sausage is made. It's always best to invent new, mysterious foes as opposed to building increasing canon based on old ones that were best left mysterious. But the Borg do in some ways provide a related phenomenon to the zombies, that of a technological cyborg zombie, that also is making heavy use of nanotechnology, but in a bit different of a way. Rather than airborne, these nanobots were injected during assimilation, but you can think of other ways of doing that, in both deep space and in a planetary atmosphere without the need for injection. After all, yes, some viruses, for example, are bloodborne, but some are airborne, or can just infect someone merely by touching a contaminated surface. But back to polar bears and humans, driven to actions they wouldn't normally take, except when faced with starvation. We live in a very young universe. It's basically a toddler still, with the vast majority of its existence ahead of it rather than behind it. And this introduces a third kind of zombie, but the most plausible perhaps, and in this case it may be universal, or nearly so at some point. Here's where it gets spooky. The universe is very long-lived, but not infinitely so, and it's expanding. So the general distances between galaxies will overall grow. Also during this, the Milky Way itself will age, star formation will begin to shut down, and it will settle into something like a giant elliptical galaxy after its merger with Andromeda. Then it will redden, in the sense that the shorter-lived stars will die off, and the only active stars will be the red dwarfs. Everything else will be cinders and black holes. In this aged universe, though, also comes time. What we know of Earth is that it took life a very long time to develop outside of its microbial stage. Microbial life here emerged at the very first moment it could, but then it stagnated for 1.5 billion years in its simplest form. We really don't know the rules here, known as the prokaryotic to eukaryotic leap. What we do know is that it might not have been the great filter that some had suggested in the past, and may just have been a product of symbiosis. This means that Earth could actually have been a latecomer to this game. It may happen even faster on other worlds. But if it is a delayed filter where it takes most planets with life that long or much longer to reach, then complex life and intelligence is something for the far future, and we're quite frankly early in the game. It's possible that the solution to the Fermi paradox is very simple. Earth just had the right conditions and the right luck to develop life early on, only just over 9 billion years after the universe itself came to be. It might be that, on average, life takes much longer to arise and develop on exoplanets, and that's why we see the Great Silence. But we have to be cautious here, in that we have only just begun to characterize the atmospheres of exoplanets, and we simply do not have enough of a sampling of atmosphere profiles to say much yet. But if in the future, say 2 centuries of searching, we find no convincing evidence of an alien biosphere at an exoplanet, then we will have to start asking the question about if Earth is simply early. It doesn't appear early. Nothing about this world seems special enough to say it's unlikely to have any analogs in the Milky Way, but there may also be unforeseen factors within abiogenesis on Earth that make Earth relatively rare, but maybe not rare forever. The reason for this, again, is the titanic amount of time the universe still has to viably live, trillions of years, meaning that the longer it goes, the more life it is likely to produce. This means also that as it ages, the chances for intelligence also rise. In the far future, say 10 billion years from now, there may be no great silence, and the galaxy will be abuzz with the very radio signals SETI now looks for, perhaps prematurely. As intelligence arises and colonizes the galaxy in the future, we may yet see something like the vision of Star Trek, with alien species interacting with each other and possibly making treaties and empires. Perhaps in a state of peace, given that in 10 billion years, there will still be plenty of room in the galaxy for everyone, and then some. To dent the Milky Way on the real estate front, you'd need far more than tens of thousands of civilizations to cover its 100 billion star systems. But at some point, that comes to an end with the death of suitable stars and the expansions of future civilizations. Eventually, everything becomes generally locked in, where intergalactic distances, due to the expansion of the universe, go more or less off the table, and civilizations in the Milky Way have to look to things like black hole farming and existing around dim red dwarfs. And that's where the zombies come in again. Zombie civilizations that ply the Milky Way on a quest to corral all of the remaining resources to extend their own longevity. They may come across other such ancient civilizations, also seeking longevity in a dying universe. But they might also come across budding new civilizations that arose at the unlucky end and must be eradicated or assimilated to continue the existence of the older, more powerful civilization. But all is not lost. The future may not consist of turf wars, energy seeking, and warfare, but an idea that all life is precious, and that the alien species of the far future will seek to coexist and collaborate until it's finally time to turn out the lights and close the door for the existence of life in the universe. I wonder where we will be in those days, trillions of years from now. Will we be players in the great galactic game, playing out at the end of the universe? Or will we be an extinct species from a long destroyed planet that no one knows about? Or will we be some flavor of ancient aliens someone out there wonders about, based on whatever scant evidence remains of us? We, in our current position, can't ever know. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently bringing up an event horizon blast from the past. One of the first guests ever for the show, and indeed the very first Halloween special, was a conversation I had with psychologist Dr. Travis Langley about the psychology of a zombie apocalypse. It was the closest I could get to hard science on zombie apocalypses at the time, and an interview well worth a visit, link in the description below. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.